Mina, konbanwa, JesusFreakinGamer here. We're going to be reading 1 Kings chapter 3, not the entire thing, tonight, but the first few verses in it is where I'm really getting the message from, because it's really important to understand that God works with us where we are, in our imperfection, in our not knowing sometimes what the heck we're doing. I'm going to start with verse 1. Now, Solomon made a treaty with Pharaoh, king of Egypt, and married Pharaoh's daughter. Then he brought her to the city of David until he had finished building his own house, and the house of the Lord, and the wall all around Jerusalem. There's mistake number one. He married a woman that had, she wasn't an Israelite, and she did not worship Yahweh. It was a marriage political treaty, and that's all there was to it. And that ended up really hurting him in the long run. We'll get into that later on. But that was mistake number one, marrying someone who wasn't a worshiper of Yahweh or an Israelite. So he goofed up there. He should not have married her for political reasons. Verse 2, meanwhile, the people sacrificed at the high places because there was no house built for the name of the Lord until those days. And Solomon loved the Lord, walking in the statutes of his father David, except that he sacrificed and burned incense at the high places. That's mistake number 2. So the people are burning and sacrificing at the high places. Solomon's burning and sacrificing at the high places, even if there wasn't a temple. And don't know what happened to the tabernacle. I know that the ark was carried out to battle. They lost. The Philistines captured it. God broke out in the Philistines. They returned the ark. David eventually reclaimed the ark. And it's not really said what David did with it. It's like he placed it in an open-air tabernacle. I covered that in a message kind of, sort of, a few weeks ago. It's not the Old Testament, at least. I don't think the New Testament mentions the tabernacle of David. It sounds like just the Ark of the Covenant was in a place. Makes me wonder what happened to the original tabernacle. I know that Solomon's about to build a temple here in a few chapters. Something big and grandiose thing David wanted to do. But and all of that was a giant tangent. All of that to say that was mistake number 2. Even if there's no tabernacle whatsoever, the Old Testament lays out very clear descriptions of what you should do to build your own handmade altar, not using any man-made tools on the altar, lest it be defiled, but an all-natural altar to the Lord. There was a way to do that. That way, if you wanted to make a sacrifice to the Lord and you weren't near the tabernacle and you couldn't make the journey physically for some reason, there was a way to sacrifice to the Lord literally in your backyard on your property. Solomon didn't do that. He used the high places that were there. And I guess the high places were left over from the Canaanites. I know the Israelites did we covered that a few months back. The Israelites did a very sloppy job of taking care of the Canaanites and leaving some of them in the land. So I'm guessing the high places were simply their leftovers. And instead of being torn down like they should have been, they ended up getting used and being sacrificed on. Solomon's sacrifices were to the proper God, to Yahweh, but he wasn't. That's still strike number 2. He's still not sacrificing the way the Lord told him to. On to verse 4, now the king went to Gibeon to sacrifice there, for that was the great high place. Well, I guess that was the best of the best. I guess it would be either the largest or best land or best view. Who knows? But apparently that was the great high place. Solomon offered 1,000 burnt offerings on that altar. At Gibeon, the Lord appeared to Solomon in a dream by night, and God said, ask, what shall I give you? And then follows the famous story of where Solomon asks for wisdom from the Lord. So he's got 2 strikes against him back to back. And in the middle of that, the Lord's like, Solomon, what do you want? What can I give you? How can I bless you? It's important to note that the favor, the Lord loves all of us, Christian and non-Christian alike. The Lord's blessing and favor lies on the Christian, on those who believe in him. Those are the ones that God knows. Those are the ones he is intimate with, those who have accepted him as their Lord. And in the middle of Solomon's mistakes, the Lord grants him amazing wisdom and also promises him, you know, great political affluence, great wealth and health, all these wonderful things. And Solomon's not getting some essential things right. He's not even worshiping the Lord properly. He's not even marrying the person he should marry. And the Lord blessed him in the middle of that and blessed him greatly. And I'm not saying this is not a license to sin and do as you please, but it's to encourage you. If you've got some things wrong in your life, and quite frankly, we all do, the Lord can still bless you. He can still speak to you. You can still love Him and be following His statutes in your heart. You've just got a few things wrong. You're doing a few things messed up. You're committing a few sins. You're fighting a few battles and you're losing a few battles. Keep pushing, keep striving, keep studying and recognize what the problems are, but don't think that God isn't with you because you're not perfect, because He is. He can be with you quite strongly in the middle of your imperfection. I want to encourage all of you with that story in Scripture tonight. Thank you very much for watching this video. I love you, and God bless.